dong 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 be do be dong 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 be do be dong wah 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 wah.
Well, I mean, by New York School, I'm thinking of Frank O'Hara, Kent Coke, John Ashbery, James Schuyler, and others. I saw their work, but my interest was more in Allen Ginsberg and Gregory Corso, say, and Kenneth Patchen, and then the so-called Black Mountain poets, Robert Creeley. My interest shifted away from the Beats and the Black Mountain writers. I came to New York City in 1960 to begin attending Columbia College. When I came to New York, though, I was very lucky to be assigned Professor Kenneth Coke for the year-long humanities. Kenneth led us through, I mean, like at breakneck speed, a lot of reading in that course. It was wonderful, actually. Led us through these great books. Started with the Iliad, I think, and ended with Crime and Punishment in, you know, 1 year. And it was really great. And he was one of the most, he was actually the best teacher I ever had. He was absolutely amazing. Yeah, he made my mind open up to other kinds of writing and ideas that before I had dismissed in advance. He also showed me comic possibilities in the way he lectured. He wasn't like a stand-up comedian or anything, but he had an incredible wit. And I realized that, I came to realize that it's okay to be witty in writing. You don't have to be so grim. I started reading all these other writers that I had never even heard of. Kenneth told me about other writers, and I took every course I could that Kenneth taught, and we became friends, actually. And I was more than just a student-teacher relationship. After I graduated, he was very helpful to me in a lot of ways. Got me a Fulbright to Paris. His generosity was wonderful. There was actually less energy in Paris, and there were fewer art shows and whatnot. But there's a whole culture to discover, and a whole language, and and all of Europe is just right there. And a history, also the feeling that you're in Paris, you can feel directly connected to the past. Like you could almost look down a corridor and see it. In New York, you don't feel that. You look down a corridor and you see 1970 maybe, but you don't see, you don't really feel 1720 here. In Paris, you could feel 1100. You could, or go to Notre Dame or somewhere like that. It's physical, it's there. And it's such a beautiful city too. Visually, it's much more beautiful than New York.
Le grand amour qui commence dans la cour se poursuit dans les tours et rime toujours avec toujours. Mais le contexte est plus fort que le concept, son mec.
I wrote my first collaborative poem with Ted Berrigan, actually, when I was still in high school. And it was only after I was in New York a year or so later that I started collaborating more with Ted. And that same kind of high energy humor and craziness continued, although we weren't being so scabrous. But yeah, writing with Ted was always it wasn't really like ping pong, it was more like arm wrestling. But tickling your opponent at the same time. So yeah, it was competitive because he and I were friends, but we were also competitive, and which really I thought brought a lot of energy to the work we were doing. I don't think they did much collaborating at the Cedar. Gossiped and smoked and got in fist fights. But I spent time in museums and art galleries and bookstores, and especially movie theaters, because there was some, at that time, there were wonderful movie theaters here showing foreign films and old classic American films and film noir, and the Bleecker Street Cinema, the Thalia and the Symphony, and the New Yorker, the Charles. There were lots of theaters that I guess just don't exist anymore as movie theaters. I really liked the Museum of Modern Art a lot. It was small, relatively small, and kind of intimate, and no one went there. It was totally unlike it is now, which is insufferable as far as I'm concerned. But I like MoMA a lot. Oh, you didn't call it MoMA, then you called it the Modern. Just next door to it was the Whitney at that time. Mm-hmm. The MoMA was on 53rd and the Whitney was on 54th, but they were connected by a doorway. You could go from one to the other. I like the Met, too.
Thank you.
spent a lot of times in art galleries too. We didn't have any money, so we had to try to find things to do that didn't cost anything or cost very little, like riding the Staten Island Ferry or walking around at Wall Street at 2 in the morning, which is no one there, and it was just weird and interesting. Or walking across the Williamsburg Bridge, coming from Tulsa to New York was a huge quantum leap in energy, excitement, scale, diversity. I mean, it was just staggering. Joe Brainerd, my friend from Tulsa, he and I were in high school together in Tulsa. Actually, we'd been in first grade together too, but just being around somebody who was a born artist, Joe didn't have to become an artist, he was an artist from birth. You could just tell what he drew. Some people have it and some don't. But yeah, he was very inspiring to be around. Did some work with Jim Dine and Alex Katz and some others that were friends of mine. In 1960, the poetry world seemed kind of small compared to now. You kind of knew who people were. And now, I mean, there are probably some good poets, but I never even heard of them. I wrote letters to poets we admired and writers we admired at the time. Just said, we're starting a magazine. We're only 16 years old. And we're only in Tulsa. Please, please send us something. I wrote a letter to Allen Ginsberg. And we wrote a letter to Jack Kerouac. Allen, particularly generous, wrote back these postcards. And I told him I was going to Mexico on a school trip. He said, oh, here's what you must do. He wrote me all this advice. And then I told him I was coming to Columbia. And he said, call me when you get to New York. Another poet that we published, a man named Simon Perchik, he said, oh, do you know Joel Oppenheimer? He's a poet. And I said, well, I've read your work and blah, blah, blah. And he said, oh, here's Leroy. You know Leroy? And I said, oh, you're Leroy Jones. You know, I'm Ron Padgett and stuff. Oh, yeah, we're going to this art opening tonight. You want to go with us? And I mean, you know, it was like, well, sure, you know. And we got invited to this party, and we go, and it's like at Larry Rivers' loft, or so I can't remember where it was. You know, and there's Frank, and there's this person, and that, and you're meeting all these people. It's really great, you know. And then, so I met Frank a few times in that context. I kind of said, you want to come to dinner at Frank's? You know, I mean, my wife and I are coming. You and Patrick come, and blah, blah, blah. I was like, sure. So, you know, and then through them, sort of, you go to this party and you meet this person and you meet these other people, and everybody was, I think, remarkably welcoming and generous and unpretentious. You know, I mean, God knows what was really going on amongst these people who are older than me, and they're more experienced and more sophisticated and incredibly witty, and they drank, and you know, things got strange. But you know, I don't know. I didn't know what was really going on, except that it was exciting and fun, and people were great, and they were welcoming some young person like me.